have practice questions here. These are all the ones that I wrote, and it's dealing with the concepts of the ergonomics and not, you know, from the exam core or the actual test and everything else. And but you know, ergonomics is usually a high percentage of injuries, you know, 1/3 in some of the facilities I go to. I'm a big fan of the stretch and flex, and you know, the idea is if your muscles are loose and flexible, then you're going to have less injuries. And you know, 30-second stretches is what is recommended, and you can stretch literally all the major muscles. Here they're doing the squat and they're stretching, you know, obviously the glutes muscles as well as the hamstrings. And these are different things that people are doing to help become more flexible. Because if you're stiff, you're going to be carrying less weight because you're not carrying it correctly. So we'll get started. Ergonomics is in all the major BCSP tests, from the CHST, ASP, CSP, and I didn't count the OHST, but that's, you know, also in there. Again, you have to know the body mechanics and lifting and vibration and all these other topics. The trouble is you will not have to do the NIOSH lifting equation, which is good. I call it a trouble is because they're going to ask you questions about the equation versus doing the actual math. So ergonomics was, you know, coined by a Polish scientist, Wojciech Jastrzębski, if I said it right, a couple hundred years ago, and talking about how the muscles are affected by the work you're doing and how you sit and how you work with the areas. So you can imagine, you know, if you're this worker in the middle with a big, huge nail gun, it's a lot of weight, and your shoulder muscles and your biceps and elbows are going to take a lot of abuse over a period of time. And you know, everybody has a number where they're going to eventually fail. They're going to have problems with the muscle, and the person's going to have you know, strains, sprains, other issues that are going to be, you know, affecting them. Could be even vibration. Push and pull, like on the right, you know, we tell people to go in and try to have no more than 35 pounds. That comes from the snook tables, Liberty Mutual. And you know, I just use two fingers. If I can pull an object or push an object with two fingers, it's probably going to be okay. But this is a lot of injuries also with pushing and pulling. And you know, there's going to be a lot of terms. Of course, you know, you got OSHA, Occupational Safety and Health Administration, NIOSH, National Institutes of Occupational Safety and Health. And then we're going to have other ones. Musculoskeletal disorders, what we're talking about, you know, the ergonomic injuries. Some people call it disease. Repetitive strain injuries, or I just call strains. Carpal tunnel syndrome is a problem in the wrist with repetitive motion and typing. A NIOSH lifting equation, the NLE, I just call it the lifting equation. Hand and arm vibration and whole body vibration. So I always look at ergonomics when I first started looking at where did it start coming into law and where did people pick 70 pounds. It's the U.S. Forest Service. You know, they talked about, you know, lift with the legs and the arm. That's the first place I really saw that. And avoid twisting motions, because twisting pushes on the discs on your back, and that's going to be bad for the back. And then no more than 70 pounds for a man and 25 pounds for a woman. And that's where the 70 pounds, a lot of people have used that number. And if you're able to lift it and you do it properly, that could be okay. If you don't do it all the time, I mean, all the time means, you know, you're doing several lifts a minute of that weight. Some of the accidents I run into, and I get involved in court a lot as an expert witness, is, you know, they're lifting too much. You know, a person's going to lift a 130-pound pipe off the ground. Maximum weight recommended usually is 20 pounds. But young worker lifts it up, loses controls, hits another worker in the head with the pipe, wearing a hard hat, which saved his skull from being fractured, but they had fusion second nami, and that means fuse the vertebrae in his back. He has problems with standing up and balance and dizziness, and now the losses are over $2 million. That's a lot of money for not trying to get something in there for a lift assist device to lift this piece of pipe. And this is what we talk about. How are you going to lift the heavy objects on your site or on your workplace? Because you don't want to use people to do this. You know, we've got three different ergo hazards that I see. You know, ergonomics, when you look at 1,000 injuries, it's going to be about 300 injuries on it. The common one is going to be you're going to have problems with your back. You're going to have some bulging on the disc, pushing on the nerve. The disc can thin out over time and cause nerve compression, mechanical back pain. Not going to be fun. This is what started the whole OxyContin painkiller crisis. You know, like one of my friends, Rex, he got one pill a day as needed for pain, became one pill every hour, buying it on the black market, going to jail, and everything else like that. Horrible, because the pain was in there. And, you know, there's a lot of people, I mean, I would say probably at least a third, they do not want to get spinal fusion. And spinal fusion means they would take out the disc, go through your stomach, and then pour amorphous gelatin or protein in it. You know, I always tell people in Chicago, you know, the Rush doctors are probably the best back doctors in the Midwest. They have success on this. But you have to understand what's happening. There's a lot of times, you know, people have things where it goes wrong and they can't lift much. A bulging disc means it's actually ruptured the disc. It's pushing so hard on the nerve of your back, you fall to your knees. And I've had that on several of the companies where I've, you know, dealt with these injuries. Usually lifting something 50 pounds off the ground. That's all it is. You bend wrong, you haven't been trained to lift, you're not able to do it, and it just puts so much pressure, the disc goes and you fall. And that requires surgery. You can't get out of it. You can't even move. You know, you're not going to go out and, like on the bulging disc, you can, you know, sometimes do yoga, chiropractic, pain medicine, cortisone shots, but when you get a bulging disc, you have to get surgery because there's no way you can get up. Rotator cuff's a tendon, and you know, one of the things that, you know, I always talk about, I lift weights all the time, you cannot make this stronger. You can make it more flexible, but if you lift a lot of weights, like some of these running backs in the NFL, I watched one of them lift 660 pounds this summer, and I says, you know, you make your muscles so strong, you're going to rip the tendon. And that's exactly what happened this year with him. You know, I sat there, it's the muscle becomes so strong. The tendon can only handle so much, you know, pull and push, you know, pressure. And your muscle's so strong, when it flexes, it can rip the tendon. And that's something we always tell people. You don't want to, you know, make the muscle so huge and so strong that your tendons can't have it. And if you don't stretch and make it more flexible, now you've got a tight muscle with a tight tendon with a strong muscle. The ACL, little ligament underneath your knee, if it rips, you're not walking. You're not playing basketball. You're not doing anything. Very expensive ligament to put back. When Derrick Rose was with the Bulls of playing basketball, it was $1 million for his ACL to get repaired. It took him a year to get it, you know, working, and his knee working. And the next year, he ripped the other ACL on his other knee, you know. And that's not good because it's hard to come back from this. So I got several knowledge checks. These are, you know, questions that are talking about the concepts. What are the three main causes of musculoskeletal disorders? We can go into the chat, and I'm going to move the chat over here, and you can just type up the answers. Exposure duration, static postures and frequency, repetitive motion, forceful exertion, awkward static postures, pressure points, intensity, action, twisting, repetitive motion, and duration. If you want to just try to guess what it is, type something in the chat. And nobody can see your answer, so you won't get embarrassed. It's going to be repetitive motion. Very good. Forceful exertions, awkward static postures. This is a typical exam question. The main thing is, like I said, we always try to go in and think about what, you know, is probably the best answer. You know, usually when you can throw out right off of the bat, you know, intensity of action, pressure points. Pressure points probably not going to be in there. But, you know, static postures can cause issues, and duration of exposure, how often you're, you know, doing it. These are not bad answers, but, you know, they're looking for the best answer, and that's a tough question. Carpal tunnel is when the median nerve gets compressed in this ligament, the transverse carpal ligament, it's going to swell. You're going to get some tingling or numbness in your fingers, and eventually you're going to be like my mother, which had surgery on both of them. They're going to cut the ligament to relieve the pressure and everything else. You know, you can do different stretches, you know, where people are, you know, flexing the wrist back and stretching and holding for 30 seconds. That'll help out a lot. But an ergonomic workstation or trying to eliminate the cause is the best way. 500,000 surgeries per the New York Times on carpal tunnel with an average 29,000. So, you know, you're talking a lot of money with carpal tunnel. And like my mother, one wrist, she had only 10% loss of strength, and the other one she had a third. You know, her right hand, she lost a third of her grip strength and everything else. So, not good. A couple of musculoskeletal disorders or diseases. Trigger finger means you keep on pressing a trigger all the time. And, you know, you start doing this, you know, 800 times in a day. We see it on keyboards where you're pressing, clicking a mouse, same thing. Going to cause some swelling and inflammation. And we always try to tell people, report the injury as soon as much. Let's get the thing treated. The Quavin's tendonitis is, I see, from cell phone texting a lot. The thumb tendon is going to get overused and inflamed, and it's going to cause a lot of pain. They're always going to ask you about some of the effect of cold on the test. You know, what's trench foot? Raynaud's phenomenon is a common one. It's a blood flow issue by overuse, cold, or, you know, stress. And you literally lose the, you know, blood flow in your fingers. So you got to know these kind of ergonomic related issues. And, you know, so usually heat related and cold related, even though we're not covering it in this class. De Quavin's tendonitis. This is a person that had the wrist inflammation. It hurts. And eventually somebody, you know, brings it up and said, hey, my wrist really hurts. And it isn't the wrist. It's the thumb tendon. So they, you know, put athletic tape on the area, try to keep it stiff, and they come back in 2 weeks and it's not any better. And then you get what I call the boot, or in this case, the thumb cast. Now they've immobilized the thumb and you can't flex that tendon. You're going to get 6 weeks to heal. It's almost like a broken bone, but it's going to be a chance for it to heal. So very common question about, you know, what is this disease cause? You know, if you get overuse of the, you know, the elbow, it's going to be epicondylitis. You have to know a little bit about these type of diseases because they will ask you about the workers working with his elbow hammering apart. And next thing you know, his elbow's inflamed. What could that be? And it would be epicondylitis or tennis elbow. We saw a lot of it. And tendonitis is just a swelling, you know, at the hand, wrist, wherever it's going to be. Rotator cuff, very injury. Remember, it's a tendon. It's going to swell. You're using your shoulder muscles all the time. More than 2 hours a day is what I always say. You're going to start pushing that muscle, and now you're going to have some issues with it possibly. So what is De Quavin? Blood flow issues, nerve and blood vessel compression in the upper chest, a former trigger finger, tendonitis on the thumb side of the wrist. Very good. Going to be tendonitis on the thumb side of the wrist. And there's several risks and causes. You know, forceful exertion, pushing and pulling, static postures where you sit for a long time. You know, my rule of thumb is if you're going to sit for 8 hours a day, you're going to have some problems over, you know, 40 hours over several years. Repetitive motion, always an issue when you start to overuse the muscle more than 2 hours a day. And then, of course, there's going to be pressure points where you're pushing all the part of your body all the time. And vibration's going to be an issue, and we'll talk about that. The worst vibration is what they call low frequency. That means the frequency is this peaks, what's the distance between them. High frequency, it's much closer together. The amplitude's high. So this is going to be the amount of waves. You can measure this on an item that's vibrating, and you know you can actually see what it looks like. But low frequency, high vibration is the highest risk. Something that moves very fast can cause problems too. None of it's good. You know, if your arm starts going numb or your elbow goes numb, after 30, 40 minutes using that tool, that's where you probably want to think about maybe changing the tool, getting some anti-dampening material, vibration gloves, etc. Food companies, you know, this is the 50-pound bag of food product, rice, slour, whatever. People put it on the floor, take it from the caver, put it on the little cart, blow their back. This is everything from manufacturing to construction. If you got something that's heavy, I tell people, if you're going to move it from the conveyor to the pallet, it's 20 pounds. Otherwise, get a lift assist device. So one of the students in my class, you know, she got her company agreed to buy a lift assist device for about $15,000. You have to remember, when you get these back injuries that are recordable and you've got treatment, average is about $50,000. You know, there are back injuries that, like I said, you know, I have $1 million case where he's lifting and it costs, you know, a lot of money. But a lot of times I get them up $600,000, $400,000. So they can get quite severe depending on how bad the rupture is and, you know, what kind of age of the person and what kind of condition they are. But this is what they do. They lift it up, they put it over here. If it's routine repetitive lifting and this is done for several shifts, then get a robot to do it. But you know, if you're only having a few bags every so often, take this, no pressure to lift it, just move it, place it, and now you don't have to lift this area. You know, when I was with OSHA and I was doing a lot of these evaluations, you know, 20 years ago, this wasn't out there. You know, it wasn't something that was very used very. Now, you go to any manufacturing show and stuff, they got all these vendors that show what their latest one is. Their mobile versions of this and everything else. When we look at it, you know, one of the company's travelers gave me some data a few years ago. Material handling, a third of the data. It matches what I see all the time. That's going to be a common issue. Okay, now we'll go back. Which tools are considered high risk for vibration? Low frequency, high frequency, low amplitude, high amplitude. That's a tough one to remember. And, you know, this is one of those ones that, you know, if you don't remember it, you know, try to eliminate. Very good. Low frequency, high amplitude vibration. And, you know, when I work with insurance company, even though it's, you know, 13 years ago for some of them, stuff is not the, has changed that much. You know, people, same surface falls, always 20 to 25% of the accidents a lot of times. When they even looked at the deaths, you know, OSHA said 104, I mean, BLS 2022 data was 144 deaths out of the 5,400 were same surface falls. So going to be an issue to deal with. It's not really an issue for, you know, every employer, but, you know, if you can fall, trip, you know, pallet sticking out, that's it. But I was surprised, you know, when we went through 4,000 of the industrial companies, 200 companies had a $250,000 loss. And the reason I bring it up is there's not a single company in the United States, if you don't have a $250,000, the boss doesn't know about it pretty fast, because that's a lot of money. It's going to take, if you're at a 5% profit margin, you just divide this by 0.5, you know, you got 4 millions of sales, and that's a lot of money for anything. And non-routine lifting, you know, when we went through a lot of these, were non-routine lifts. You know, you're not lifting the box or the bag every day. This is a person that's coming in and hasn't done this and lifting something maybe 50 pounds or so, a 40-pound box of paper or something else like that. So that's something to think about too, because if you're not used to it, you're not acclimated, and that can cause an issue with newer employees. Now, the NIOSH lifting formula is going to give you a recommended weight limit, RWL. In the OSHT, you will have to do this, but the other tests that most people are taking, you don't have to do. But they've asked you, what is the frequency multiplier? How many minutes is it? How many lifts do you do in 15 minutes? Not a good question, but they do ask about it. But they're going to have you know, the horizontal location, the vertical location, and you're going to come up with a weight limit. So if you go out to the best situation, the load constant is going to be a best of 51 pounds. That means you're moving the object between your knees and shoulder as close to your chest. That's your best number you can get, if everything else. They have the NIOSH lifting equation app online. That's what I use when I get, if I want to do this stuff. I can do the math, but it's so much easier just to put down these numbers in the app and get the number right away. When I go to court and I'm trying to show that they're way over the recommended limit, then we have to actually calculate it. That's where I would use it. Again, the lifting index is taking the weight of the object divided by the recommended weight limit. We want it to be less than one. We want the object to be lifted lower than the recommended by NIOSH. If it's over it, then you're lifting too much and you expect an ergonomic injury or a musculoskeletal disorder. That's how you're going to use this. So if you go to this site, OSHA.gov, and you just type ergonomics, you'll get to this area. They show you how to, you know, just put in these numbers in and go through it. I'm not a fan of it. NIOSH does a better job of it. They give you an example here. Here's 35 pounds. We're going to lift it up to 27 inches, and they actually go through a case on this case. In this case, the origin's 28 pounds. You're going to go over there. While moving it to the destination, the maximum is going to be, you know, 18 pounds. So, again, you won't have to do this on the major test. Only the OSHT would require you to do this, and we're not going to cover that part. So they're going to ask you a typical case. I just used a case that I did with a $55 billion company because I was trying to show them we can calculate the recommended weight limit of this object that they're going to put on a pallet jack, and the object is 110 pounds. We do the formula, it comes out to be 27.5. So they're going to give you these two numbers in here, and they want to know what the lifting index is. How much is it? Remember, we want the lifting index below 1 if it's good. So this is the one that when people get this test on the CSP, ASP, and other tests, they freeze because they're trying to think, I know I can't do it, but what's the lifting index? Remember, they're going to give you the formula. Thankfully, they'll give you the lifting index is the loading weight divided by the recommended weight limit. You don't have to calculate that. They're going to give it to you. So that's nice. So what do you think the lifting index in this case is for the task? What's example low frequency? I use leaf blowers as a good example. You know, anything that you're holding, yes, very good, A. Very good, it's going to be A. Anything that you're holding that you feel vibrating is going to probably be low frequency. High frequency, you feel it, but it feels like a tickle, as I call it. Low frequency, you're feeling the amplitude. You know, I have a vibration meter, and it can tell you, you know, how much it's moving. You know, so if it moves more than 0.2 inches, that's a pretty low frequency, and you're getting a lot of movement. High frequency, it's not going to feel like it's moving at all. You just feel it, you know, coming up. So I don't like the leaf blowers. The gasoline powered leaf blowers have a lot of problems. The weed whackers same way, because they have a lot of vibration on them. And you know, so when I work with the workers, you know, is it low vibration? No. If you get problems, you can feel it. That's how we handle it. You know, you've got an issue, it's causing any kind of tingling in the muscles, let's get the dampening equipment. Going to electric has helped out a lot. But you know, you can buy gloves. I played with vibration gloves over, and I find out a good set of leather gloves with a liner inside is pretty good for vibration, you know, just from playing around. So one of the big companies I worked with, you know, this is kind of like the NIOSH formula, but in real life. You're going to lift from your, you know, shoulders to your knees, hold it close to your body, and if you're going to take it from your waist where he's holding it and move it exactly to a place exactly on your waist, you can lift about 50 pounds. If you're going to set it down from your waist to the your about knee level, you know, using your back, bending with your legs, you can go about, you know, 41 pounds and stuff. So, you know, it's, or 47 pounds, but you can see on the floor, it's 20 pounds maximum lift. And you know, this is the whole issue. You know, people misunderstand it's 51 pounds. They think it's from the floor to wherever. No, you know, you can't lift that much off the floor. You know, your knees are not that good. Your back is not that good. You're in an awkward posture trying to grab it. So, you know, this is easy. All you have to remember, it's on the floor, it's 20 pounds. 50 pounds, right? Is it right at your waist level, and you got a good grip on it and everything else? Otherwise, you're going to lower it down. And again, you're going to sometimes they give you the question about anthropometrics. I'm probably saying it wrong, but Da Vinci did the famous drawing with, you know, the person in the circle and the hands are outstretched. Then Mr. Bertillon started talking about taking measurements. What is normal? What is the average? What is the height from the, you know, the posture, and they started applying it. Because, you know, you think of something simple as, you know, putting a steering wheel in a car, you're trying to make the largest percentage of people that would be comfortable. But there's people that drive cars, it's not comfortable. They're too tall, they're too short, not as easy to deal with, maybe because they're bigger or smaller. And these are things that they have to consider when they start, you know, looking at it. Remember, not one size fits all for all these designs. You know, and you've been in cars that are probably too tight, you know, amusement rides that are too tight, too loose. That's not good. Same thing as anything for body harnesses. One size does not fit all. You think you can adjust it, but it's not going to work. So I just go to this chart. This is, you know, got to be a chart from the 90s that I used when I was doing a lot of ergonomics. I started doing ergonomics back in, you know, the mid 80s and stuff. And we did a big case at an automobile dealer where we cited $910,000. $10,000 for every ergonomic injury they didn't record. And it seemed like I was out there forever. But, you know, we were doing time and motion study. That was something I remember learning in school, and videotaping each of these tasks. And we, you know, if you're going to go raise an axle above your head several times a day, that's a risk factor. You know, anytime you bend anything in your body 30 degrees, your wrist, your arms, everything, you got a risk. Will it happen to everybody? No. You know, again, you know, a lot of times it's genetics and luck and everything else and your physical conditioning, but it's a big risk. Simple thing is sitting, squatting, moving your elbows by your shoulder 2 hours a day, it's going to cause problems over a period of years. You know, it doesn't appear right away usually, but it takes time, and that's how we approach it. So when we work at these facilities and other places, you know, because I work with one of the big, you know, a couple auto facilities, this is what we focus on. You know, we got to put a racing stripe on a car, concrete floor, getting on their knees, 4 injuries a year. Doesn't seem like much out of 800 employees, but let's get this person a stool that you can sit in with wheels and just put the racing stripe while sitting, and then you get up to do the other stuff. And simply, it goes away. Simple like that. People can't believe some of these solutions are like $30, you know. So we learned in the 80s, you know, lift with your legs, go with it. This all sounds great if you got good knees and you got a good back and the object can be lifted. Remember, we're looking at 20 pounds when we do this, not 50. That's a big difference. This is a big thing. I mean, I was in court with one of the persons and they made the big mistake. They said, oh, we can lift 100 pounds. I said, no, you can't. What book are you looking at that to get it? Nobody's, NIOSH is 51. You're telling people can lift 100 pounds and you got all these, a lot of injuries. You know, you're a $30 billion company and you can't have anybody run ergo. You don't even have an ergo program and you're just giving advice, you know. That's not good. Lift tables were big. This is the thing we had in the 90s. You know, we found these things and we told people to do this, bring it up. Today I would just say, if it's a 35-pound package, get the robot or the vacuum lift to go in and do that, because you can do it. We don't want to lift awkward. We want to lift a door because it's too heavy. You know, even a 35-pound door, if you're lifting like that, that's pretty hard. So what's the recommended best practice for injury prevention while handling materials? Always bend at the knees, not at the waist. Maintain straight legs. Lift with your back. Bend at the waist, not at the knees. Always bend at both the waist and the knees. Well, that's a tough one because it's kind of like three answers that are not bad. One you can throw out right away. You know, we're not going to lift with our back. We know that's not right. Very good. A is the answer. Bend with the knees, not at the waist. And fatigue management is an issue. You know, there's studies, the RAND study, if you get less than 7 hours sleep, you're going to increase the amount of injuries, and by the time you get less than 4 hours sleep, you're definitely going to be, you know, 3 to 7 times more accidents than that. And people, remember, you can always lose sleep. I don't care how good you are. There's something in there from outside, from fireworks to the dog barking to kids to other people, that you wake up, you don't feel good, you're not going to get to sleep. I mean, I wear a watch and I can tell how many hours of sleep I get every day. And, you know, my goal is to try to get 7. You know, because that's ideal, not 9, not 10. But, again, when you're tired, you make mistakes. You know, there's been plenty of studies, like if you went into the explosion on the oil rig in the 90s, where or 2000, whatever it was, fatigue was an issue. You know, we have sometimes people working 90, 100 hours a week during some of these chemical plant turnarounds, and that's just too much. People are going to make some bad decisions and do things that I've seen happen and cause, unfortunately, several deaths. So we try to manage it by scheduling it. You also have to be conscious. If you're going to switch people from day shift to night shift back to day shift, the body cannot get used to it, and they're going to have problems sleeping. The solution is not energy drinks. You know, I mean, I have some people that are doing it. They're taking 3-4 of these. That's going to be bad for the health. You don't want that. That's not going to be good. You need rest. Fatigue is usually accompanied by a loss of efficiency. Which type of fatigues are likely to be experienced by employees in construction work settings? Social and static, mental and physical, mental and social, physical and static. Well, that's a tough question. But you think, if you're the worker and you're pretty tired, what are you feeling personally? Very good. Mental and physical fatigue. Very good. So fitness for duty is important because, you know, you can't give people that can't do the job. One of the things that I'm arguing with one of the big warehouse chains is that when you start, you know, they pick people, you know, they're hired from the street, and, you know, it could be somebody like me or anybody else in the classroom, and they give you an orientation, safety training, and, you know, you might walk half a mile the first day. And the second day, they're going to watch you, coach you, and everything else, and you might walk 3 miles a day. And then the third day, you're up at 10, and by the time you're fifth day, you're walking 20 miles a day. And that's going to be your job for 5 days a week, 6 days a week, 40 hours, 60 hours a week. I mean, some of these people I'm talking to, I mean, it's amazing amount of miles they're putting on their feet. They track on the wrist. And they're saying, wow, I walked 23 miles today. Well, guess what? The body may not be used to it. You know, for some of us, you can say, I can walk 10 miles. A lot of people can't, especially you get a little older. You know, maybe you don't have the right shoes. So, they're having injuries. And, you know, they're trying to change it. They're trying to, you know, eventually get to all robots and everything else, which will kind of work for some things, but not everything. But, you know, the medical verification, you want to make sure people are actually flexible and have good equipment and they're able to do the job. You don't want anybody coming into the work, you know, being tired, impaired. Impairment means they can't function. They have an impairment. They're slurring. They can't pay attention. They're not focused. That is not something you want. You can do impairment testing. They do this for truck drivers, and you can just take that same impairment testing criteria and use it at a workplace, because you don't want people running equipment when they're impaired. What type of injury is the largest occupational health hazard? Light exposure, noise exposure, cold exposure, repetitive motion. This is what I call a gift question. You know, you should get it all the time. Very good. Repetitive motion, ergonomic injuries. And ergonomics is matching the capacity to the worker to the task, you know, that they can do the work. And, you know, an effective ergonomic program, you're going to keep track of these injuries. You know, I can't tell you how much it's important to get the injury reported, no matter how minor, because it's a lot easier. You know, something that could be, you know, your hand being sore from, you know, vibration, we can get it treated. We can get rest, ice, compression, elevation, some medicine like Aleve to reduce inflammation, and then talk about doing it. You know, we always want to try to sit there and get these early instead of waiting till we rip a muscle or something or a tendon. Medical management, I like cradle to grave. We can come back every day. We can see it. We can, you know, sometimes go in and get it treated through physical therapy and other things when it's small. When it's a rip and a tear, now you're talking $50, $80, $100,000. And training people. You know, everybody focuses on safe lifting, but we want to talk about you know, how to go in and, you know, push a cart. If the cart is unable to be pushed, like with two fingers, you know, it sounds silly. We tell them, let's get the cart wheels fixed, because it's probably related to the wheels of the cart. But, you know, one of the big candle companies I was at, and I was doing an ergonomic evaluation, they didn't have one person make a week doing this job. You know, you're lifting 25 boxes, and you're doing this all day long, and your back's going to go out, because it's awkward. Look at this person. We talk about 30 degrees. This is almost at a 90-degree angle. You're trying to stack that pallet. You grab this box, put it on the pallet, do this, and then the next pallet comes. This is why you get the lift assist device or the robot. I mean, this is really brutal on a person. And they couldn't understand. They said, well, people are just not in shape anymore. No, the job is incredibly hard, and you're going to, you know, lose people. Again, lift assist tables are good, but I showed examples of the lift assist devices. There's several of them. A lot of them with vacuums work great. You got all different configurations. This is a common one over here. You know, it'll grab a 55-gallon drum, 400 pounds, and just move it like it's nothing. You know, I had one of the big auto companies. We talked about, you know, ergonomics in 2005. They weren't even dealing with it. Now, I dealt with one in 1987. They were doing it, and this company was like the last. And I says, you know, you're going out here, you got the tool, have something hold the tool. So you're not holding that tool, using your muscles in your arms to hold this 3-4 pound tool all day long and do these tasks. Now you're just moving it, and then, you know, maybe 120 times a day you're clicking. Makes it easier for it. And all of a sudden these injuries started dropping off, which saves them thousands and thousands and millions of dollars. With a computer, we want the wrist parallel to the floor. We want a wrist rest to try to keep and prevent this 30-degree flexion. We want the seat adjustable so that the legs get the pressure off this. Because if you got pressure on this part of your body all the time, that's a pressure point, it's going to reduce blood flow in the legs. So if that person's got the right chair and the feet can't touch the ground, then give the person a foot rest. Depends on the chair. We want to make sure we can adjust the height of the workplace, the screen 15 to 20 degrees below. You don't want it looking up. You want it looking a little slightly down, 20 to 40 inches away. You know, and that's what you want to have for a good posture, because these are things that's going to cause people. So when I get people that go to watch sporting events on a television that's up, they're out there for 5-6 hours, and their shoulders are sore because they're at that awkward posture, and that's only for 4 or 5 hours. If you're doing that all day long, 8 hours a day, 40 hours a week, you're going to have a lot of problems. Standing. I use this because, you know, you stand too much, you're going to put pressure on your feet, and you can imagine if this person, you can get on these scales at Walmart and Red Wing and everything, you can see where that person's pressures are. So you want probably, you know, a fatigue mats. Fatigue mats are pretty easy to do, 100 vendors. You can put orthotics in the shoes. I'm a fan of orthotics because I teach, and, you know, not everywhere I'm going to bring a fatigue mat. But this is what we're looking at. If you're going to be out here on this solid concrete floor and you're up here on your feet all the day, it's going to be sore. And if you're doing 8, 10, 12 hours a day, you're going to be in awkward posture. It's not going to be easy. So we can just put these fatigue mats. You know, some people say, oh, they're tripping. Well, anything can trip. I mean, you go into a carpeting, you can trip. But this is pretty good. Low amount of injuries. You know, I if you deal with thousands of hours, these are minor. But these things are cheap. And it makes it easy. I can stand on the mat all day long. It feels like my feet are on clouds. That's what you want. I like Hog Heaven, and I know tracks. This is stuff, you know, over 20 years ago we were working with. And, you know, these vendors will come in, they'll let you sample all. I mean, there's got to be 200 different vendors that make these things. You know, you find what you like, what people like, and then that's what you want to put in there, because it makes it easier for the workplace. And again, they're going to have problems. Next thing you know, the back's going to hurt and everything else, and knees are really sore because they're trying to shift the weight. Ideally, in a workplace, you don't sit all day, you don't stand all day. You have the ability to sit and stand. And you want to be able to think about, if you're going to do a workplace, can they do some other things? Can we bring in a chair? They can sit for a while. They can stand up for a while. Things like that. It's so simple to do, you know, just to make it sure that the people are not going in. This chair over here on the left is nice because it's got footrests. Because if it's just dangling, we don't solve the problem. We want to make sure that, you know, we have some kind of footrest for things that we're sitting. Here we got the fatigue mats, a lot easier. And people over here, you know, they said, you know what, I don't need to sit. I can do this, I feel good, I don't have this problem. That's fine. You know, but we can bring the mobile stools and you can sit on that and do the work too. And in summary, we want to do the high-risk jobs. We want to focus, you know, I always focus on, let's take the ones we've had in the last 5 years and let's fix those problems with ergonomics. We do evaluations. We talk about what can work and corrective action. There's a lot of solutions out there today. And then we try to set a goal. You know, we try to sit there and say, okay, if we've had 15 people get hurt putting on the racing stripes in 5 years, let's try to get it down to zero this year. And they're like, oh, John, we always get 3 or 4. No, but that's what we do. We got people pushing carts, 4-time people a year getting hurt pushing carts. Let's do to the two-finger rule. You can't push it with two fingers. The cart's too heavy. Let's get a cart. Because people are amazed that you get a 300-pound cart with wheels. You can push 600 pounds like nothing. With a good, clean floor and low friction contact, it doesn't take much, you know, because you're not lifting 600. You're just sliding on a smooth floor. And different things like that have made a difference. We want to get the medical people. We want to tell people, don't give them restrictions if they absolutely don't need them. You know, if you've got to have, you know, certain amount of hours you can stand and things like that, that's fine. But we want to make sure that, you know, the medical people understand that, you know, you can treat a lot of these ergonomic injuries, you know, with a leave, rice, ice, compression, and elevation. And then we document the ergo. We keep track of it. We watch how many happen. We take a look at these injuries as if they had a real cut physical injury. And then we look at the, you know, the process. If we can go out there and spend some money to do it a little bit easier, take away the pushing, then we'll spend the money and we can do this. And again, we always look at the worker comp claims. There are going to be some people that are going to go in here, but these are things you want. Want a pad? You got to stand up and do a forklift driving? Let's make the thing comfortable to drive, you know. Any questions? I want to thank you for coming very much. I'm going to put this on YouTube. And it'll be available for you to take a look at. Thank you.